We did this song a couple weeks ago. I'll go through the refrain and you can sing.
Okay, we're started. Thank you.
That's why we're here. Yeah. Come to the table. Come all you weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, his burden light. He is a come all you weary. Come all you weary. Come and find. Come and find. His yoke is easy. His yoke is easy. His burden light. His burden light. He is able. He is able. He will restore at the table.
Sunday of Ordinary Time. We're offering, I normally do a pro populo mass, which means for the people. You know, you have to do one in every parish every Sunday. And it's for all the petitions of everyone. So that's still true, but his beloved grandpa died on the Feast of Corpus Christi. So we're gonna offer this mass for the repose of his soul, especially Roger, that any defect or human weakness that might have remained, that God will have mercy upon it, and he's in God's tremendous light and love. Let us begin in our hope, which is in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
So as we begin this Mass, let us call to mind anything this week that has challenged our relationship with Almighty God, maybe have offended him, or the relationships we have with others, you know, maybe our prejudices or our prejudgment of things, our harshness, anything that's part of our human life that is not reflective of love and mercy, that God might teach us the way and show us his mercy.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Reading from the second book of Kings. One day, Elisha came to Shunem, where there was a woman of influence who urged him to dine with her. Afterward, whenever he passed by, he used to stop there to dine. So she said to her husband, "I know that Elisha is a holy man of God. Since he visits us often, let us arrange a little room on the roof to furnish it for him with a bed, table, chair and lamp, so that when he comes to us, he can stay here." Sometime later, Elisha arrived and stayed in the room overnight. Later, Elisha asked, "Can something be done for her?" His servant Gehazi answered him, "Yes, she has no son, and her husband is getting on in years." Elisha said, "Call her." When the woman had been called and stood at the door, Elisha promised, "This time next year, you will be fondling a baby son." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Forever I will sing the goodness of the is established forever. In the heavens you have confirmed your faithfulness. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. Blessed the people who know the joyful shout. In the light of your countenance, O Lord, they walk. At your name they rejoice all the day. And through your justice they are exalted. Forever I will sing the goodness of the exalted. For to our shield, and to the Holy One of Israel our King. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we were baptized into Christ Jesus? We were baptized into his death. We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. If, then, we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourselves as dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his apostles, "Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me. And whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Whoever receives a prophet because he's a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever receives a righteous man because he is a righteous man, he will receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives only a cup of cold water to one of these little ones to drink, because the little one is a disciple, amen, I say to you, he will surely not lose his reward." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So, vocat, is the verb of call. So, a vocation is a calling. And I would submit that that's not to an earthly thing. That's an advocation. Ad meaning to or toward in Latin. And then to that calling. You know, you're called to be married. You're called to be single. You're called to a religious life in some way. But we're all called to a religious life. And to act, you know, in that depth of charity that is not putting ourselves first, but the needs of others. And to sublimate our desires, however great they are, for personal gain, for personal stuff, is to lay that at the foot of the cross, because you're giving what you give to other people, to God himself, the very divine life that exists in all persons, or we don't live and move and have our being. Of course, we want to have the most vibrant life in Christ, but even vandals and murderers have the life of God in them. That is their spirit, and that's what animates this flesh. That's what makes it go. So whatever we're called to, you know, then to lay that at the foot of the cross. We can get all wrapped up in things that, you know, are not really true in themselves. So, you know, oh, it's a man's world, you know, and that men, especially white men, get a privilege over everybody else, and therefore, that's not a good thing. That should be denigrated. I really don't think you can go through history and find a successful man without a really good woman standing next to him and propping him up. You know, and you could say, right, that women are the pinnacle of God's creation. Right? They bring life into the world. Guys, there's a bunch of, you know, a hunting group, you know, they can't produce much except dead animals. The thing is that women have a unique relationship with Almighty God as far as love. Women, in my experience, come to faith easier than men. And it's kind of how love is formed in you. You know, that a woman's love is directed toward the other. You know, it's directed toward a husband. You know, it's directed toward, you know, the way that God brings life into the world. But she's got to submit her whole life for the life that's inside her. You know, still the greatest killer of women is childbirth. We happen to have great medicine here, and we can get around a lot of stuff that is really challenging to other places in the world. But a woman really has to lay her life down. And, you know, the baby's going to come no matter what. I mean, you don't get to choose the day or the hour. You don't get to choose how long you're going to be in labor. But you have to lay down your life to bring that life into the world. And therefore, you have a special relationship with your children that's very different than their relationship with their father. A father is absolutely necessary because men and women have different world views. It's just part of our makeup. And you need both so that we are in that communion of that God has intended. So we lay it down, you know, and then the husband has to lay down the fact that his wife isn't doting on his every whim, and she's concentrating on the baby. So he went from first to third in one shot. And with every subsequent child, you know, a father's got to lay down the fact that what is his job? What brings him fulfillment? What, you know, you don't make the babies, so you got to, like, provide for the babies. And you got to protect the babies and your wife. I mean, that's a role that is innate within us. You know, it's very different in primitive cultures versus our very sanitized and easy culture, but it's still part of our makeup. So the man has to go to work on Monday, even if he doesn't feel like it. you got to go. You got to go maybe do something that isn't the most fulfilling thing in the world, but you need to do it to provide for your family so that they can have good things. You're doing it for others. If you do it for yourself, it's a lonely thing, and you're probably not going to last very long in a relationship. In the primary, you know, male-female relationship, you have to give a little, right? Not everything. There has to be a mutual respect and a mutual giving. But what John Paul II said, donatum, is a gift, right? So our lives are a complete donation in Christ, which is love. We give love. It has things that surround it that show that, but really it's about an interior disposition of giving love to the other. And the great thing is when you find the right person and you get that love back, wow, we write great songs about it, poetry, make good art, do all that kind of stuff. Look, I'm sorry that God created us as a pinnacle of his relationship. I'm not. But animals don't get the same thing we do. Now, I know that includes having your child come back to you after college when you thought you got rid of it. But it's still the same desire to do good, right? And we do help our kids, especially when they're establishing a family of their own or they have some significant things that are challenging them and their health or personal lives. But so we're constantly, if we're doing it right, we're giving that. And that's within the nuclear family, what I'm talking about. But then that love, which we would then call charity, we extend to others so that they might receive what we're receiving. That can be in a material way. And we need to, especially in these times, and I'll make an announcement about after communion, but how we can be generous to people, I mean truly generous, in what we give them so that they can, you know, it's not just about a government handout, it's not about just throwing a blanket at somebody, it's about that they experience the love of God through us, because the reason why we give, we offer charity, is because we love God, we love our families, and wish people, you know, would receive the same. So, like, in food drives, don't get mac and cheese. Man, that's just an easy one. You know, get something you'd like to eat. Now, I like to eat mac and cheese once in a while. Same thing with tuna fish. Great keeper, it's cheap, but not everybody likes to eat tuna fish, and if you don't have a jar of Hellman's mayonnaise with it and some good bread, you know, it's just a stinky can of tuna, but it'll get you by. But there's many other things that we can give, right? Now, that's a material thing in food. We can give of our time, our particular skills, and that's talked about often. But we need to be doing that not just within the church community, and we need to do that, but we need to be able to do that for everyone else. So remember that the government stimulus check, where they're printing money, I don't know what it's backed by, but they're printing money, and they're handing money to us, you know, so that we don't go stir crazy, particularly. But, you know, it's a very superficial thing. And then we're not to be dependent upon government programs, and people are many times forced to, right, because of the way we're set up. But the true charity is from us, in a direct way of giving to others. For some people, that's giving money, but I submit to you that we then we give that money to someone who's going to convert it into something that's real. Right? A real ministry, a real outreach, a real thing so that isn't just another decimal point someplace and perhaps misused. It's important. People with money are, you know, and have the distinct calling, I think, by God, to support in larger ways than people that don't. So if you're a widow and all you have is those two little tiny mite coins and you put them in there, that is still from her, that's a huge gift. Because she gave not from her surplus, but from her need. And that's why it's recorded in Scripture. You know, kind of give till it hurts. So in our worldly family, you know, we don't want just freedom and success for us. We want that for everybody else. You know, universal health care is from the church. I mean, it really needs to kick back in. And to be able to offer that in true charity to people who can't afford it otherwise. You know, the bad thing is I've heard of people, you know, we're the government, we're here to help you, and then everybody goes, oh no. It should be that people receive and know that it comes from our relationship with God, our own nuclear family, and that they're part of our family too, even if they don't realize it yet. So, if we give, as it says in, you know, freely, as it says in this gospel, and God will acknowledge that in spirit it was given. For salvation is given not for a price. That price was paid by Jesus Christ on the cross. Salvation is offered as a gift to us, just to be received, and then to know that we are beloved by God. In times of like these, I submit everybody needs to know that in a deeper and fuller way, that we are beloved by God, and God has not abandoned us, and He hasn't sent a plague. But in response to a plague or to anything else that might befall us, is to know that we are still beloved by God. That ultimately, the greatest gift we receive is the gift of life. And we participate in that with God, in having children, in being good stewards of the creation that He gave us freely, so that we can share freely. My brothers and sisters, you know, these are times that are unique to ours. And I don't know on what level you couldn't put it, you know, that in the past century, you know, predicted by the Blessed Mother in Fatima, that, you know, this is a worldwide war going on against a thing you can't even see without real big magnification. He's told us in all these things, do not be afraid. And maybe in our own little foxhole in our house, we're not atheists. We're praying. We're loving. We're giving. We're doing what God asks us to do because we're created to do it. My brothers and sisters, be entirely generous, especially in this next weekend when we celebrate, you know, the 4th of July. And there's lots of celebrations. But particularly in our family, that, boy, are we blessed. We are really blessed. Look at today. I'll go into the, you know, like the convenience store, and I'll go, to the clerk, I'll go, if you don't like today, I suggest lower your standards. Because this is a glorious day that God has given us. And He's given us the gift of life, both corporally and communally and heavenly. And here we get to feast on the very body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Savior, that His life, His eternal life, might live within us, inspire us, and into the actions that show how much we love each other. Let us stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. and for us men, for our salvation,
he came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary.